Good morning, Aurora Church family. It's great to be here with you today. Good morning to everyone watching online. We're so glad that you've joined us. We are ready to sing. Would you join me stand this morning? Let's lift our voices together and praise our God.
The same. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam. Thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia.
Welcome to Christ Community Chapel. It is good to be here. Go ahead and take a seat just for a second. Those of you who are connecting to us online, it is great as well to have you here. My name is Mark, I'm one of the pastors here at CCC Aurora, and if I haven't met you, I would love to. But I want to tell you what's happening. I want to remind you of what we are doing here today. You have not just come to church. You have come because we are worshiping God. You have, by the Spirit of God, you have made the choice to come and declare the greatness of God. Doxologia, right? A glory saying, that's what that means. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. That is what we are going to do. That's what you've done already today. This is all of us gathered with the saints around the world to declare the goodness and the greatness of our God. I am so glad to be together. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you've chosen to be here. I hope that even if this is your first time, first welcome to you. It is great to have you. You are part of our family today. If you decide, you can let us know you are here. It's easy. You text the word Aurora to 474747. That will allow you to connect with us and let us know you're here. Thanks for doing that. That's a gift. That's all we expect from you. As the believers and followers of Jesus, we also give. We used to call them alms hundreds of years ago, right? But we give to the work of God. We give to relief of the needs of people in our area. And we give recognizing that God has bestowed on us everything. And so you can do that. You can do it online. If you came prepared to physically do it, just a quick note, there are boxes in the back to do that. We don't pass the plate at any point. So I want to let you know, one of our dear ones, Dick Riggs, went home to be with the Lord last Sunday. Dick and Donna moved here from Pennsylvania. I did Dick's funeral service yesterday, and I said we were his second favorite church, because his favorite church, the church he served for 35 plus years so faithfully, was in Pennsylvania, but they moved here in a second part of their career. So for those of you who know Dick, he literally looked like he stepped out of Adventures in Odyssey. He looked exactly like Whit Whitaker. So we miss him, and we want to think and remember Donna today, even in our prayers. Let me pray for us. Stand, let's continue, because the band is going to lead us. We're going to talk about how Jesus is our rock. We're going to continue to cry out to God about His greatness. Father, get our hearts so ready, please, because if we draw the glory to ourselves, it will crush us, but it will do nothing but magnify your magnificence. And so we want to do that today, right now. We want to join the saints throughout the world, and we want to join the great cloud of witnesses that cry out how great you are. We love you because of Christ. In His name we pray. Amen.
Not the labor.
see Jesus lifted high. I wanna 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 see Jesus lifted high.
Amen. Thank you for singing. Please be seated. Father, we lift your name up high. We are so grateful for your son, Jesus. You alone deserve all the glory, all the praise. And we give that to you today. We ask you now to speak to us through your word. Speak to us through Pastor Todd. And thank you so much for the privilege of being able to open your word together. It's in your most holy name we pray, and we thank you. Amen.
All right, well, good morning, everyone. It's really good to be together, really good to worship together with you. I want to just say welcome for those of you who are watching online. We are really glad that you could join us that way as well. Listen, before I get started, I was just going to say one of the things that I'm learning to love about this church is the generational diversity here. I really love that about this church. And one of the things I just wanted to point out is that we've been kind of looking for drummers because we've been short on drummers. And today was Aiden's first time drumming. Aiden is a freshman, and he just crushed it, didn't he? Isn't that awesome? So I just love that about this place. Well, listen, if I haven't met you, want to introduce myself. My name's Todd. I'm one of our pastors here, and privileged to be able to stand before you, humbled to stand before you to open God's word together with you. If you are new to us, or maybe if you haven't been around for a little while, I'm seeing faces come back. I know some people are coming back from Florida as the weather gets nicer and all that sort of thing. And so I just want to remind you that our theme for this year is Independence 2021. And the reason it's our theme, actually, there are two reasons. First of all, it's because we are actually on a journey this year to move towards becoming an independent, autonomous church from being a campus of CCC, and that's exciting. But there's a more important reason, and I keep saying this, and I mean it, and I don't want anybody to forget it, because I believe that if we're going to be a healthy, independent, autonomous church, that actually we won't be defined by our independence, but by our complete dependence on God and on each other. All right, so before I go in, though, to my sermon this morning, what I want to cover, I want to let you know that part of being a healthy follower of Jesus here at this church means that you would have healthy relationships with other Christians here. We want you to build strong relationships, actually so much so that we feel like until you begin to build relationships with other people here, this will not feel like your home. It'll just feel like a place you go on Sundays as a tradition until you dive into relationships. And so today is the day you have an opportunity to do so. If you're not in a community group, we are going to be launching new community groups post-Easter. And today is the first opportunity to sign up. Pastor Mark's going to tell you more about the details of that, but I really want to encourage you to start thinking about getting plugged in that way. All right? Well, listen, we are in the smack in the middle of a four-part series on what it looks like to be dependent on each other. This is a series in community, and I started off 2 weeks ago by telling you what it takes to be a real friend. And if you remember, what I talked about is that there are three ingredients to real friendship. And I'll get to those in a second, but what I wanted to tell you is that I used ingredients for a reason. I was very intentional about using ingredients. And I'll tell you why, but I wanted to let you know something you may not know about me. And that's that at the Ionetta house, we've started a tradition where actually dad makes the birthday cakes. Right, so it's kind of an interesting thing. I started it early on. I think my brother did it. That's where I got it. And I started making cakes. So, and I am not by any stretch like a professional cake maker or baker, but it's been a fun tradition for us. And so I will go up to the kids maybe a week or so before their birthday, and I will say, kids, what kind of cake do you want this year? And they will let me know, and I will try to make their cake dreams come true. All right, I'm not the cake boss yet, but So I've made cakes, like I've made Elmo cakes, and I've made Odell Beckham Jr. cakes, and I've made rainbow unicorn cakes. I mean, and that was actually one of my favorites. I feel pretty proud of that one. But anyway, I really focus a lot on the design of the cake and the way it looks on the outside. That's obviously something that is really important, but you can't neglect the inside because the kids at their party need to taste it, and it needs to taste decent, right? And so you can't miss like three of the main ingredients. Like if you miss sugar or flour or eggs, I mean, you miss, like the cake just doesn't taste good. You just miss one of those ingredients. And I think it's the same way when it comes to friendship, when it comes to biblical community, that if you're missing one of these three ingredients that I introduced to you, then you are actually not a good friend. You're missing one of the key ingredients. And so let me remind you what those main ingredients are. And that's that a real friend would be trustworthy, would be transparent, and would be truthful. And so what we're doing is, you know, that first week, I glossed over each one of those and spent like 3 minutes on each one, it felt like. And so what we decided to do is to break those down and to actually take a look at each of those ingredients in detail to see why they're so important when it comes to biblical community. And so last week, Mark started that and he talked about trust, the importance of trust, that it is the foundation of every friendship is trust. Not only is it an ingredient in friendship, it is the first ingredient, it's the foundation, all right? This week, I'm gonna talk about the next ingredient that's really important, and that is transparency. All right, so I'm going to give you three things that I think are really important about transparency in relationships with each other, and here they are right now. There's the power of transparency, the impact of transparency, and then the response to transparency. So there's the power, the impact, and the response. If you have your Bibles, open them to 1 John 1. And then we're going to put it up on the screen, or you can follow along on your smartphone. But I'm going to start with the power of transparency, and we find it here in this passage. 1 John 1:5-10. Here's what it says. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say, once again, if we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. All right, so listen, first what I want to do is I want to start by saying that God is light, and that's really important, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. So what this passage is saying is that if you say you have fellowship with God and you're walking in the darkness at the same time, it just doesn't work. It's really not a relationship much at all. Now let me tell you what walking in darkness means in this passage, just so we're clear. Walking in darkness means that you are sinning, but you have not admitted it to God or to anyone. So you are in sin, but you're not willing to come out with it. That's what walking in darkness means in this passage. And so what John is saying here is if you are walking in darkness, you say you have a relationship with God, but you're walking in darkness and you're not willing to admit your sin, then you're lying to yourself and you're making God a liar. Okay? It's pretty strong language here. Let me explain, I think, what I mean with a little story. So when my kids are young, but when they were even younger, every once in a while, you know, with little kids, you catch them doing something wrong, and they don't think you see it, but you see it. And so, but they deny that it happened. So like, for instance, I remember a time where we went to one of our kids, I won't mention which one, but I went to them and I said, did you just steal a cookie without asking? Did you take a cookie? And they looked at me and they said, no, with like chocolate all over their face, right? I mean, it was plain as day. We saw them take the cookie, and yet they thought if I just deny it, if I just say it didn't happen, then maybe all of this will blow over. But as parents, we saw exactly what happened, and it's our duty as parents, and it's the best thing for our kids to admit it to us. Because if they're not honest about it, if they don't admit it to us, what's happened is they are lying, and they are calling us liars for thinking that they did that. And it's the same way in this passage that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. So the interesting thing is about no matter how much you try to keep sin in the dark, what happens is God sees everything because he is light. And if we are never going to admit that we're struggling with sin, then we are lying and we are making God a liar. And so what I think this passage is saying is it's really difficult to have a healthy relationship with God if we are unwilling to be transparent about our sin. But also, what it's saying is that it also impacts our ability to have good relationship with each other. Let me show you what I mean by that. In verses 7 and 8, it says this. It says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another in the blood of Jesus. His son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. All right, so there's something powerful. So we're not supposed to walk in darkness. We're supposed to walk in the light. But something powerful happens when we walk in the light. Not only do we begin to have right relationship with God, but what it says is that we have fellowship with each other, that the relationships with each other start to get really good when we walk in the light. So the question then is, that we need to answer is, what does it look like to walk in the light? All right, and I think sometimes you could think that walking in the light means that there's an expectation that you would be perfect, that you would never mess up, because walking in the light means that you never mess up, you're always above reproach, you never sin ever. That's not actually what this passage is saying, because look at what it says. He says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we are perfect, if that's what it means to walk in the light, that we are perfect, we don't need Jesus to cleanse us from anything, because we've got it all together. That's not what walking in the light means. Let me tell you what it means. Walking in the light in this passage means that we are walking with God in such a way that not if we sin, but when we sin, we will see it, because God is light, so there'll be light shed on it. We will admit it. We will confess it to God, and we will move away from it. That's what it looks like to walk in the light. And of course, we are supposed to confess it to God, but here's what I want to talk about today. If we want real power to overcome sin, not only do we need to confess it to God, but what this passage is saying is we need to have a trusted friend that we confess it to. We need to be transparent with each other. And that's really, really important to note. Remember what I said 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, I talked about how we were created for relationship with others, that we weren't meant to do this life alone. You weren't meant to live this life alone, and you weren't meant to try to deal with sin all by yourself. And so what I'm telling you today, that if you happened to be in sin and all you do is just confess it to God, you will not have the accountability around you to actually move away from the sin. You have to bring others into it. that are trusted people, because that is that's where the real power to overcome sin can happen, in relationships that are transparent. James 5:16 says this. James 5:16 says, "Therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed." All right. So if you want victory over sin, if you want to be healed from sin, there's power in confessing it to one another. But I would encourage you to build the trust first. I'm not saying that you just start going around telling everyone everything about yourself. Build the trust first. But I'm telling you that the power is when you bring your sin into the light. So let me tell you a quick story. I had a friend who really struggled with an addiction. For a long time struggled with an addiction, and he didn't tell anyone about it. Just kept it to himself. This is a Christian guy, okay? And what would happen is he would struggle with this, he would fail, he'd feel bad about it, he would confess it to God, and then the cycle would happen over and over again, and he never brought anyone else into it. And it got to the place where he did it over and over and over again till it came out in a really ugly way, and he was caught, and it almost destroyed his marriage. And it was devastating for him because it was the first time that the light was actually shed on his sin. And when the light was shed on it, all of a sudden he realized just how much he was destroying himself and the people around him. That's what it looks like, by the way, to walk in darkness. You are in sin and you probably know what you're doing, but you don't even know how bad it really is until it comes out into the light. And once you bring it out into the light, you can actually see how it's killing you, how it's killing the people around you. It's really hurting people. And so for this particular friend of mine, he actually had, for the first time, he had friends and family who knew about this struggle that he was dealing with. And he said it was the worst and the best day of his life. He said it was the worst because of all the consequences he was going to have to face because of the sin that he was dealing with. He saw it all come to a head. But he said it was the best because it was the first time in his life that he had no secrets. It was the first time in his life that people who loved him, his family and friends, knew everything about him and loved him enough to begin trying to help him work through it. And that's when he began to work on this particular area of his life and begin to overcome. See, what I want you to know in particular is that if you're ever dealing with a habitual sin in your life, then what you need to know is this, that as long as you keep it in the dark, you don't even know how much it's hurting you or hurting other people. And what's easy to believe is that when you keep it in the dark, that you've got this thing all under control. I don't need to bring it out to anybody. I can control this thing. But if you keep it in the dark and it goes long enough, the end is destruction. It really is. And so what I want to tell you, this is heavy stuff today, but what I want to tell you is the real power to deal with sin is when you confess it to God, but when you also bring it into the light and confess it to a trusted friend or a trusted group of people. There's a story in the book of Luke that I want to share with you. There was he was always with sinners. He was always with sinners, and Jesus was at one point dining with tax collectors. He was at a tax collector's house, and it was a group of tax collectors. Now, if you know anything about tax collectors, they were notorious for being terrible, terrible people because they would charge people more than they needed to charge them for the taxes, and they would pocket the excess. And so they were really stealing from the poor and making people poor so they could make themselves rich, and everybody knew it. And so the Pharisees, who were the religious leaders of the day, they come up to Jesus and they say, "Why, Jesus, are you hanging out with tax collectors?" And this is what Jesus says in Luke 5, verses 31 and 32. He says, and Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. I want you to know something, that if you have ever dealt with sin in your life, if you're dealing with particular sin right now, if you ever think that you'll deal with sin in your life, that you are in good company. Welcome to the club. This is not, by the way, a club for righteous people. That's not why we're here when we worship like that. This is a hospital for sinners. And so if you are ever in a situation where you find yourself going down an ugly, dark road of sin, what you need to know is Jesus wants you. He came for you. It's the whole reason he came. And I think what Jesus really wants is for you to bring it out into the light, because that's where Jesus does his best work. He came to offer forgiveness. But you've got to bring it into the light. That's the power of transparency. But that's just the first one. That's the power of transparency. The second is the impact of transparency, the impact. So the Apostle Paul, he wrote the majority of the books in the New Testament. Some would say the Apostle Paul is the greatest missionary of all time, because he went all over the place to share the gospel, started so many churches. And the Apostle Paul had written this book to Timothy. And Timothy was a younger guy who Paul was mentoring. And so you could look at 1 and 2 Timothy almost as a mentoring letter. And before Paul gets into any of the things that he wants to say to Timothy to try to encourage Timothy in his faith, he makes this statement, which I think is so impactful for the rest of the letters. And this is what he says. 1 Timothy 1:15. Paul says, "This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost." I love that. Because what Paul was doing before he told Timothy what he should be doing, he said, "Listen, Timothy, I want you to know, I need Jesus as much as anybody. I've got just as many issues as anybody else. I need him." I mean, Paul was complicit in killing Christians. Paul knew how bad of a man that he was, and how it was through nothing on his own that he was saved, but only by the grace of Jesus. That kind of transparency, that kind of humility, I think had to have incredible impact on Timothy as he read that letter. Now, let me give you another example of that. So before we came here, my wife Jillian and I, we led a ministry called Reengage. It was for married couples at the Hudson campus. And I may have shared this before, and you might get sick of me talking about it because we loved the ministry so much. So I'm sorry. But Reengage, what made it so powerful is there was a culture of transparency and vulnerability. And the way that you create that culture isn't by just saying to people, "Hey, make sure you're transparent." The way that you create that culture is you model it. And so what we would do is, the very start of every time Reengage would meet, is we would gather everybody together, and there would be a married couple that would get up on the stage and they would share their marriage story. And they wouldn't share the happily ever after roses and butterflies story. They would share the story, the actual story. And so we had stories of people that have dealt with and overcome infidelity and addiction and anger issues and emotional problems and divorce and remarriage and and all kinds of different things. But what would happen is, it was amazing when that couple would get up and they would share very transparently about what God has done in their marriage, even in their struggles. All of a sudden, the whole place became a safe place for people to open up. Because there was clearly people sitting in the audience that dealt with all of those issues. And if no one was going to start the transparency, then nobody else was going to ever be willing to open up about those issues. How would they ever work on their marriage if they couldn't be transparent? Right? Because transparency is impactful. And it started, and by the way, the first couple that got up and shared their story was my wife and I. Because it was so important to us that people would see that we're not perfect, that we're sinners just like you, that we've struggled. We want a culture like that here. Now, nobody wants a friend who acts like they have it all together. And so if you're somebody who is sitting here going, man, I want other people to be transparent with me. I feel like everybody's fake. Well, let me just challenge you. If you are not transparent and open and vulnerable with others, they are not going to be with you. And I have to tell you this, that people who act like they have it all together, I have found make really terrible friends. All right? Because what happens is transparency actually breeds connectedness. There's something that happens that I think that's exactly what John is saying in here. Is he's going, if you walk in the light, if you are open about your sin, you have fellowship with one another. There's connectedness happens. So what would happen in re-engage is that we would go from a couple sharing their marriage story to small groups, and they'd have 16 weeks with the same group of people. And because of how we started off, people would be open and willing to share about some of their struggles. And as they opened up over time and built trust with these couples, what would happen is they would develop these really strong relationships where after 16 weeks, which some would say that's forever, I can't do 16 weeks, but 16 weeks, they would not want to stop meeting with these people because they had, for the first time, tasted real community. Some people said 16 weeks of this was better than 5 years of being in whatever community group I used to be in, because transparency breeds connectedness. Now, let me just pause for a second because I want to just do a little side note that relates. Would you pray for me? Would you pray for me? Because I am a human being. When I ask you to be transparent, I am not trying to hold myself to a different standard as a pastor. I hold myself to the same standard. And I just want you to know that I am very capable of sin. And I am very capable of sin in the worst of ways. And I struggle with sin. And I battle sin. And so I hold myself to the same standard. And I just want you guys to know that. It's really important to me. Because I meet with an accountability partner twice a month that I feel really comfortable saying anything to. And I just started meeting with a group of guys that I feel I'm hoping to feel really comfortable over time being really open and honest with them. Because I know what I'm capable of. And I also know that over the last 5 to 10 years, and even lately, you've seen this pastor after pastor, big name pastors, spiritual leaders just failing. All of a sudden it comes out that they've been living a double life. And that's devastating to us, especially us who have followed these people. And I want you to know, I'm not saying this condemning them. I'm saying this, that I am perfectly capable of going there if it's not for the accountability of people. And I want to tell you this too, that I don't pretend to know exactly how and why all of those failures happened in different churches and pastors and spiritual leaders, but here's what I think could be the case. I think it could be that they had nobody in their life that they felt like they could actually be transparent with. And they're men just like I am, just like you are, and they are capable of sin. And when sin creeps in, if it's kept in the dark, you are walking in darkness and you don't even know how big of a deal it really is. And if you never have someone that you can be open and honest with, or you're too prideful because you think, man, I'm a pastor and I should have all this stuff together. I should know how to do this. No, you shouldn't. You're a human just like everybody else. You should be the one that has just as much accountability, because if you fail, not only does it affect your family, but it affects a whole church or a whole ministry, and it devastates people. So I want you to know I'm capable of this, and I want you to know I have accountability, and I want you to pray for me. If you ever see me and it seems like I don't have those kind of people in my life, kick me, all right? Because it's so important to all of us, and especially not excluding me. 1 Corinthians 10:13 is one of my favorite passages on sin and temptation. Let me read it to you real quick. Let me read it from there because I'm not going to be quick to find it. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. I love this passage because what it says is there's not one temptation or sin that comes your way that God doesn't give you a way out. And what I would say is this, your way out could almost always be that you have a trusted friend you could tell. If you don't have one person in your life right now that you could call or text and say, I massively failed, then you need to get one. Because oftentimes that's your way out, and all you have to do is take it. All right, so that's the power of transparency, the impact of transparency. Lastly, the response to transparency. And here's all so far what I've told you is that I think all of us need to be more transparent about sin in our lives. But what I want to do now for the end here is I want to talk about how important it is, how we respond when somebody is transparent to us about their sin. Because I believe that the greatest transparency killer in the church are judgmental Christians. And because some of you are sitting here going, yeah, I love the transparency thing, but there's no way I'm going to open up to anybody about my sin because last time that happened, it came back to bite me. Last time it happened, somebody just ditched me or they didn't listen to me or they didn't care or they betrayed my trust. And I'm not doing that again. And I get that if that's you. And I'm sorry if that is you. But what I want to tell you is your response as Christians to someone who comes to you, especially with a really sensitive sin issue, will make or break their relationship with you and possibly even their relationship with Jesus. So if somebody comes to you and they open up to you and they share something with you, you need to know they had the courage and the humility to come to you. So probably they are in a place of humility and it took them a lot just to get to that point. So just remember that. Your response will be remembered for the rest of their lives. And I want to share a story of this because hopefully it'll help. I led student ministries for a long time, and so when I was doing middle school ministry, I had this group of leaders, of volunteer leaders that were leading small groups of kids. And they're really important positions because these kids looked up to these leaders. And I had one particular woman who was about a 20-something-year-old girl who was a single girl, and she was leading this group of middle school girls. And she was doing a great job. She set up a meeting with me one day, and the meeting, she came to it and she said, Todd, I want you to know, she said, she confessed to me that she was pregnant out of wedlock, all right? And she was sorry about it. She felt like she needed to come and confess it to God and to the church. And she also knew that it probably might affect her position in leading and, you know, that there were going to be consequences to it. But I stopped her and I said, listen, I want you to know, my opinion of you doesn't change. God's opinion of you doesn't change. That I love you, that we love you as a church, and more importantly, that Jesus loves you. And when I said that to her, it's not to toot my own horn, but when I said that to her, she began to break down and cry because she didn't know how I was going to respond to it. And a long story short, we had to have harder conversations and, you know, we had to make decisions of her stepping down out of her leadership position because we didn't feel like it was the right move for her. But she was humble and she was open-handed and she wanted to make all the right decisions. And what ended up happening is she had that baby. And when she had that baby, the small group girl's parents threw a baby shower for her. And she came to me and she asked me to dedicate the baby. And years later, she met a man who she ended up wanting to marry and she asked me to officiate the wedding. What I'm trying to tell you is your response to somebody who is transparent with you could impact them for the rest of their lives and affect their relationship with you and with Jesus. It's really important. I'm going to finish with this, that there's another parable that Jesus tells in the Bible. And it's found in Luke chapter 18. Interestingly enough, it's also about a tax collector and a Pharisee. And here's what it says. Jesus says, two men went up to the temple to pray, and one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Then Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. I love that. The one who was justified before God was not the one who pretended they had it all together. The one who was justified before God was the one who brought his sin into the light. Let's be the kind of church that doesn't come in and pretend like we have it all together, but build the kind of relationships where we can be transparent with each other about our sin, because let me tell you, that's when Jesus does his best work. Let me pray. Father, you are so good in giving us Jesus. We lift his name high because we cannot lift our name high. We are helpless, helplessly dependent on the finished work of the cross. And so, Lord, I pray that you would deepen our relationships with each other, make us more transparent, more honest, and help us to respond to each other with love and with grace and with mercy. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together and join in singing this song as we do. Do not miss the truth that Jesus is our great high priest, knows everything about us, yet he is before the Father interceding for us. We can be transparent with each other because we can be so completely transparent with him. He knows everything already. Recognize there's so much safety in what this song communicates to us in light of what we've just heard. Let's sing together.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace, the King of glory and of grace, the King of glory and of grace, the King of glory and of praise, the King of glory and of praise, one with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my
Church, well done. We have declared his greatness well, and now we go and we are the church. We experience what Todd described this morning, the way we do it one simple way, through our friendships in our community of faith. We call them community groups. They're small groups. April 14th is when we start. It's called Romans Together. It's going to be Wednesday night, because some of you are already in groups, and that's awesome. Be in them, make them strong, practice what Pastor Todd talked about today. Some of you not yet in groups, we want to provide that on-ramp. You said we want to try to get in. We heard you. Here it is. Wednesday nights, we'll have new groups here. Even some of our old groups will come and join us, and they'll meet. But the new groups will happen here so that we can provide childcare. And we will meet in various places throughout the building. If you're not ready to come back, maybe you're joining us online, you're saying, I'm almost there but not ready to come back, Zoom options will be available. Watch your email box today. You'll have an email opportunity to sign up, or later today, aurora.ccchapel.com. Easter is coming, my friends. It is 2 weeks from today, and we will be celebrating, well, Good Friday. Typically, we have communion the first Sunday of every month. That's Easter, but for Easter weekend, we celebrate on Good Friday, so please join us Friday night at 7 o'clock, too. All right, take 1 second and think about somebody in your life that you love, that you want to pray for and be the presence of Jesus in their life this week. And as I send you out with a benediction, join me and be ready to go be the church. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God the Father, the constant fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon each one of you until we shall meet again, or until our Savior comes, and then forever. Amen. Go and have a great week in Christ.
Creation knows the voice that spoke into the void, the breath that brought the dust to life, and sang the stars to fold. The darkness fears your voice that drove it back before. And though the night is long, I know your light will drive it back once more. Wide away from change on your authority.
Lost a battle, no, you've never lost a battle, and I know.